Madam Secretary, can we get the roll call?
Commissioner Andrade?
Here.
Commissioner Dickerson?
Here.
Commissioner Pratt?
Here.
Commissioner Seifert?
Here.
Chair Hernandez?
Here.
Now we're going to move on to approval of the Planning Commission minutes of March 30th, 2016. Has everybody had a chance to review the minutes? And if so, can I get a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of, where are we at?
March 30th.
March? What date?
30th.
30th.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
A little shaky.
Those opposed? Motion carries.
I'm going to abstain.
Thank you. So with that, we will move on to the public comment period. Each member of the audience may address the commission on any subject within the commissioner's business. Each member of the audience and each subject is limited to discussion of 3 minutes or is otherwise directed by the chair. I did get one slip. There is a public comment by Han. So if you'd like to come up and speak and state your name and address for the record.
Hi, my name is Hans Deuce. I'm a resident of Solbank, 1501 Laurel. I have recently moved my business up to Santa Maria. It's Hans Deuce Blacksmith. So I just wanted to come in here and introduce myself. We're looking forward to many good years up here in Santa Maria. Transplanted from Buellton. The business is over 33 years old. We do custom lighting fixtures, manufacture them, ship nationally and internationally. I am an involved person. I'm currently on Solvang City Council. I am Mayor Pro Tem. Just finishing my second term. We'll see what I do in November. So anyway, again, this is an introduction. Greetings to the Planning Commission, and thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, with that, we're going to move to the consent calendar, and I'm going to recuse myself.
We have a recusal, so consent calendar is approved with one motion. These items are read only on request of commission members. Should anyone, including members of the public, wish to discuss or disprove any item, it must be dropped from the blanket motion and considered as a separate item. Were there any written or any slips for consent items? I don't believe so. So we have one item on. We need a motion.
I'll make a motion that we approve the consent calendar as presented.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries, and it moves back over to the chair.
We're going to move on to item number 3, which is the Libertine Brewing Company conditional use permit at 2325 A Street. Staff?
Item number 2.
Item number?
2.
2. I'm sorry. The item number 2, the development agreement for Enos Ranchos project has been withdrawn.
Yes, just want to make it clear on the public record because it was, it did have a public notice that went out that the item is withdrawn, and so there will be no action on it.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Now to item number 3, which is the Libertine Brewing Company.
Madam Chair, I need to recuse myself on this item. I am, my business is located within 500 feet of Libertine Brewery's present location.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Can't go without that.
Addiction. It's an addiction.
Okay. If we can get the staff. Yes.
Good evening. Didn't have a mic on. We're going to do an abbreviated presentation. Yes, item 3 is the Libertine Brewing Company located at 2325 A Street. As you recall, we had a meeting on April 6th, and there was a motion that was made. Obviously, continued to this meeting. Based on that motion, the permit was amended. You have that permit in your hands tonight as far as the amended conditions per your request. Also, just a quick update, there was a community meeting on April 15th. I think some of you attended that meeting, and the applicant could provide more information on that later, but that, it sounds like it was well-attended. In addition, there were some letters that were sent out to you or handed to you to this evening, and so you have that in your possession as well. Other than that, we can answer any questions or you can go ahead and take comments, but that concludes the staff presentation. You have some slides up if you need to refer to those, and here's the project site on the screen. Other than that, we're available for any questions at this time.
Questions?
I just have one matter of clarification because I think there was some confusion from last time. Mr. Sims, who was objecting to the CP, I think erroneously we kind of, some of us, or at least myself, thought that his business was across the street. It's actually directly across the parking lot, right? So they share a parking lot. It's not across a street.
That's correct. It's directly south of the site. We can go back maybe to the other slide. Yeah, I can't really see it from there, but not to the east, but directly south, there's a building across the parking lot. So that's correct.
Yeah, I just wanted it for the record. That's fine.
Any other questions from the commission? And in the staff report, you said that you would report what occurred at the meeting.
Yeah, good point. I actually did not attend the meeting, but staff did attend, so Mr. Gilley can expand on that.
So the meeting was held at the project site, and the applicant walked through the through their operational plan. There was a lot of questions and such, and staff's hesitant to report too much on what was said because very few people at the meeting made a commitment that I am for this, I am opposed to this. But overall, the vibe was positive. But since then, we have received additional emails and letters.
Okay. Now, we're gonna move, there are some public comments that people would like to make, so. Does the applicant have a presentation or any comments they'd like to make?
Good evening. Eric Newton, 6027 Altamira in San Luis Obispo, representing Libertine Brewing. I'd like to start by saying thank you to the commissioners and the staff for seeing this proposal again so soon after the last meeting. It means a lot to us that you guys make this a priority so we can get back to our normal business and starting to promote our brand in the Santa Maria area. The past 2 weeks period gave us enough time to follow up with a few of your requests. At the request of the Planning Commission at the last meeting, we were tasked to contact some of the current petitioners to see if we can draw their support by educating them about our operations. I can report we have done that and went above and beyond that by holding an outreach meeting last Friday at our location. First, I personally did my best to contact all the petitioners by phone to explain our operations. And of the 9 signers that were on the petition, we reached all but 3. I'm happy to report that after discussing our operations, the majority were at least neutral on this CUP request here. And I have two emails that I'll hand Brian here that people that did make the meeting that are at least neutral towards our operations. A few of these parties also attended that were on the petition to the outreach meeting, and I feel it was a successful education tool as they either turned out to support us or are currently now neutral. There's 41 buildings in this industrial development, and I only know one to this date that one party against us right now. 3 of them I couldn't get a hold of to ascertain what their current position was, but the rest of these parties that reside in that development are either neutral or in support of us. I feel that we went above and beyond to fully address all the concerns to date, specifically that of parking and alcohol safety with both the city and our neighbors. We've made substantial efforts and agreed to a few controlling conditions to make the city, our neighbors, and concerned individuals comfortable with our operations. I think that it says a lot to our efforts that the Marshall Arts Academy, a few doors down from us, which is a family-oriented business, now are neutral on the CEP. In addition, we have attempted several times to reach out to Mr. Sims just to further our discussions with him and maybe set up a line of communication for any concerns that may arise in the future. Although their attempts were ignored, we believe our business is a positive addition to the development, and we believe our business will not have any negative effect on his operations for several reasons, such as our off-hour operations, our parking plan that we put in place, our alcohol safety plans, our professional clientele that will be residing there, the occupancy limits that you guys did place on us, and a six-month review period to ascertain how we're doing out there. There are so many success stories of breweries and wineries existing in industrial parks all over the state of California. Even locally, you have Buellton, Tin City in Paso Robles, the Ghetto in Lompoc, the Funk Zone in Santa Barbara, all exist within industrial complexes. And to tell you the truth, most of the hours of operations of these businesses are from noon during the weekdays too. So us putting further stipulations in the hours just makes this more successful for us being in this location. We truly believe our management will have success in this location. We currently have tremendous support in the community and newspapers and social media, and believe that Libertine will be a great addition to the Santa Maria community. We look forward to a bright future with Santa Maria and hopefully be participating in community events such as Farmers Market on Friday, and possibly doing a few of our own. One last point that was raised during the outreach meeting that we have not addressed yet was the CUP stays with the building. And I want to mention that this is true for everything that you guys do on all the CUPs that you approve throughout the city. And I can assure you that we're planning to be at this location for a long time, and we are the owners of this building. So I feel this shouldn't be a concern with anybody. I want to say that we are agreeable to all the modified conditions that you have in your current report. Although it puts certain stipulations on our operations, we feel confident that with time, we'll be able to prove ourselves as an outstanding business in the community and prosper along with our neighbors. We believe that all concerns have been addressed here, and we ask the Planning Commission to unanimously approve this proposed tasting room. Thank you.
Thank you.
We also have couple of letters and then the sign-in sheet regarding some of the neighbors in San Luis Obispo, and here's the sign-in sheet saying support and neutral.
Any questions of the applicant?
I have a couple of questions. So when did you purchase the building?
The first week in March.
First week in March, okay. And do you own the buildings in Morro Bay and San Luis as well?
We do not own the building in Morro Bay, but San Luis we do.
You do, okay. The CUP specifically states that you are not going to be doing any brewing in there. Sunday's newspaper indicated that you had some kettles in the thing, and then when I drove by, I saw a fairly large aluminum vats that looked like brewing vats in the southwest corner. Are those brewing vats, or are those some sort of a container vat of some kind?
No, we're doing no brewing at the Santa Maria location. Those are fermenters where we transfer the product down there and it ferments for several weeks in there before we bottle.
I see. Okay. That's it. That's my questions. Thank you.
Brett, any questions from you? No? Okay. And with that, anything else that the Planning Commission would like to add?
I have a question of staff.
Oh, you do? Okay.
I have a question of staff. Have we had the Chamber of Commerce weigh in on this matter at all?
We have not asked or received any information from the chamber.
Okay, thank you.
We did receive some written communication, a lot of written communication, and so now we're going to move on to public comment, starting with Rebecca Robinson. You can state your name and address for the record. And it's going to be limited to 3 minutes.
Oh, yeah, no problem. My name's Rebecca Robinson, and I reside here. My business happens to be in San Ynez. However, I've worked in this self-employment. I've been a mail carrier here for 23 years, and I find it really sad because Santa Maria, and I deal with a lot of businesses here because I'm not on the same route. It's really sad. There's very limited technical jobs here, and I am kind of familiar with Mr. Sims because I also have relatives in the machine shop. And it's really sad to have another alcohol hangout. I see a lot of problems with it, obviously, because I'm on the street all the time. And I just don't want to see just our technical jobs leave Santa Maria, because again, they're so limited. And it's just sad. I don't want to see another alcohol hangout. I've also worked in Los Olivos with all the wineries. There's a huge problem with them pulling out on 154, always has been, but now it's scary. I don't even want to go there on the weekend because I'm not sure why the cops don't even patrol that, because there's a ton of people that should not be driving. They've been drinking and they're all over the road. And that's another fear I have, because we got a lot of that. I know everybody's really aware of the drinking and driving thing, but it doesn't seem to be lessened, which I'm really shocked about. Anyways, I just hope you'd reconsider, because I don't know. I think it's important. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. The next speaker is James Sims. If you could state your name and address for the record.
Good evening. My name is James Sims, and my business is at 235 A Street in Santa Maria. Been there for 8 years, bought the building because of the zoning. We wanted a zoning that would fit our business. We moved out of a place that did not fit. If it had been a beer bar or a beer tasting room across from us, I would have never bought the building. The distance is almost from here to that wall, maybe half again. Distance, perhaps two times, but we're very, very close, and we are very congested driving, and let's foresee a lot of problems. Also, I've got, I'm not sure how many petitioners I have left. I know Mr. Halverson's talked to a lot of folks. I spoke to some folks today, said he had talked to them. And anyway, so I know some people have been peeled off, either neutral or they have their own opinion. I respect that totally. However, a few people I've talked to are still adamantly against it. Perhaps those are the ones that Mr. Newton missed. I understand Mr. Meyer, who's the original developer, wrote a letter to you folks and opposed it. There's a gentleman, I understand he's authorized to speak on his behalf tonight. So I'm definitely against it. Example of Santa Maria Brewing is not a valid example to use as a stepping stone to put it in our place, because Santa Maria Brewing, if you look at the picture of Santa Maria Brewing, it's very open. This is the same as you folks saw, except this is a picture I downloaded from Google. There's big open space here, and there's only like two buildings, maybe three or four offices around them. So it's not a valid comparison to put it in our place. It's very congested. I have no idea how it's going over there, but that just the tightness is very different than ours. So it's not a valid place, not a valid condition to use to put it in our place. That's my opinion. I'm worried about the occupancy. You folks have settled on occupancy, but how are you going to control it? How can the folks control it? Are they going to turn people away? Are the people going to be standing outside waiting to get in? I understand they cannot serve outside. Talk to the ABC folks. So that's illegal. But what about the people who come? Are they going to turn them away, send them away? Where do you park them? I have a picture here on the meeting of the 15th, and this picture happened to be someone came out and said, hey, somebody's parked in the wrong place. This is a picture, and that sign right in front of that car says no parking anytime, no stopping. This is at 4:30 on Friday, the meeting night, the day of the meeting. just happened to see it and said, oh, that's interesting. This is what we can expect on A Street. I mean, it doesn't sound nice, and I have no problem against the folks here. They're nice people, I'm sure. They're welcome neighbors, but just do not want the beer tasting room. It's basically a bar, and it's going to probably force me to sell my building. I'm worried about the price, because the next people I've got to disclose, they're going to see what we're right beside.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next speaker is Paula. If you can state your full name and address for the record.
Good evening. My name is Paula Gijon. I live at 403 East Mariposa. I've been a resident of Santa Maria for over 20 years. And as I said at the last meeting, I work for Sims Machinery as a mechanical engineer. I've been there for almost 8 years. And as Mr. Sims said, and you know, the concern that he's had, it's, you know, basically the zoning. And we do have problems with parking spots, and we do work weekends. We are an international company, so we just a couple weeks back, we were on call for somebody that was in Singapore doing a job. And so, you know, if we need to go get information, we're going to be there whatever time of the day it may be. And, you know, there potentially is a possibility of not being able to find parking. And I'm not sure exactly how that's going to work so that they don't park in our area, but that is definitely a concern. And then my main concern is the fact that if this does come alive, that Mr. Sims may decide to move his company, which, as I said last time, I've heard from a lot of people that Zodiac is laying off people, Mafi Trench is also laying off people. A lot of the engineering places are suffering right now, and it would be very detrimental for my family if I lose my job or if I have to move. I just purchased a home in October, and so it would be definitely really bad for my family if Mr. Sims decides to move because of this coming alive. So I hope you take this into consideration, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Okay, once again, Mr. Hans. Have another public comment.
Thank you. I'm still Hans Deuce, 1501 Laurel in Solvang. I can speak to this some comments that the applicant made. Regarding Builton, I was on Industrial Way in Builton for 20 years, 21 years. And to look at Industrial Way now compared to how it was when I moved down there, there has been some building, but it's the character. It is the mix. It was industrial. It is alcohol now. Wine, beer, spirits. Restaurants, tasting rooms, bars. The processing fits in manufacturing. The storage fits in manufacturing. The aging fits in manufacturing. The consumption does not. I really want to speak about something positive tonight, and that is, I feel, an opportunity for the city of Santa Maria. Rather than granting CUPs here and there that can grow exponentially over the years, to take a look at a magnet. The alcohol business is booming. It is popular. It brings people in. If an area was designated, and this is going to take some work. If an area was designated a zone for tasting rooms, for tap rooms, associated retail, restaurants, a boutique hotel. Yeah, I'm looking way out there. An area here in Santa Maria, and I don't know where it is. I'm not that familiar with it yet. where people could be out at night, where they could feel safe, where there could be little sidewalk cafes. You could pull people. This would be a magnet, and this could be part of the core. You would bring in upscale clientele in. Something to think about. It doesn't help this applicant per se, but it could certainly help future applicants to be together, to get this draw, this regional draw, and it will happen. Look at San Ynez. Look at the San Ynez Valley. It draws regionally. Look at Paso. It draws regionally. Santa Maria can do the
same thing.
Thank
you for your time.
If you work on it. Thank you.
Next speaker is Johns Hansen.
Good evening. My name is Jens Hansen. I live at 512 Sheridan Road in Arroyo Grande. I spoke last time. This evening, I have been requested by and authorized by Mr. Richard Meyer, president of Meyer Asset Management, to read a letter that he sent to Mr. Brian Halverson, the City of Santa Maria Planning Department, regarding Libertine Brewing conditional use permit. I'm reading this into the public record. Dear Brian, our position is set forth in correspondence to you dated April 6, 2016, has not changed. Staff additional conditions of approval do not mitigate the parking issue. The general public, including first-time visitors to the tasting room, may or may not park in those stalls marked by Libertine, depending upon if they are occupied or if the customer sees a more convenient, perhaps with no adjacent cars, on another owner's property. In such event, I foresee problems. To think this is not going to occur is unrealistic. There will always be first-time users, which of course is what Libertine wants. Staff conditions which are imposed on the applicant recognize potential parking problems, yet support approval with the hope problems will be resolved with the other owners. Other owners should not have to endure this. This is especially true given the conditions and the spirit under which the development was first approved. Please transmit this letter along with our April 6th letter, 2016 letter, to the Commission. Again, it is humbly requested that the Planning Commission deny the CUP. Respectfully, Richard Meyer, J. Meyer's President, Meyer Asset Management. I would also like to read into the public record part of an article that appeared in the Santa Maria Times this past Sunday, specifically a street business park owner and property manager, Richard J. Meyer, president of Meyer Asset Management Incorporated, objects to the tasting room idea. It's about property ownership rights, he said. The customers that go to Libertine are going to some off-road park and, are going to come off the road and park wherever they see a stall, Meyer said. That means they will be parking on someone else's lot. As such, that person would be trespassing and causing wear and tear on the parking lot and that portion of it which Libertine doesn't own. When Meyer's group built the industrial park about two decades ago, he said it was never the intention to provide retail space or public-oriented use. I don't have anything against Libertine. I don't have anything against the brewery, Meyer said. It relates to the city imposing something that I think contradicts what is allowed and contradicts our planned development. Thank you.
Thank you. And the last speaker, it's going to be Stephen Borgia.
Good evening.
State your name and address.
Stephen Borgia, 767 Primrose Lane, Napomo. I work for Sims Machinery. I've been there for 7 years as a mechanical engineer. And I have nothing against the brewery. Mainly, I'm going to reinforce the idea of parking. You know, as Paula mentioned, we are an international company. And late at night, weekends, we have service engineers, field service technicians out all over the world sometimes. And we have to support them. And all I want to do is be able to go in and do my job and not worry about having to find a parking spot or having a lot of people congested in that parking spot or that parking space. It is a small, tight parking lot that does not have a lot of room to maneuver. And when you have a lot of people, you're going to have a lot of congestion. So that's my main concern is just, you know, it wasn't built for a lot of traffic and a lot of people coming in and coming and going, looking for buying retail type products. It was an industrial park meant for like a brewery where you're distributing stuff, not selling it to the general population where you have people coming and going constantly. And that's my main concern. Thank you.
Thank you. Now with that, I'm going to close public comment and wanted to know if the applicant has any closing statements.
Yes, yeah, just real quick. It's hard to keep stressing the same things over and over. We're not a bar. We're a small tasting room. We'll be surprised if we see four or five cars there. We're a high-end product. We could have had a countless number of employees and friends come in and support us, but that's not what we want to do right now. We addressed every concern. Parking completely addressed it, I feel. We went above and beyond. And managing the process. We said we were going to manage the process, and I know there's a lot of comments about there, well, how can you manage the process? Well, give us a shot to manage the process, because we have put certain stipulations and plans in place that we feel will work, and we're diligent, we're a good company, we want to grow just like every other company too in the area, and I think we deserve a shot to say what we do. Or to do what we say, sorry. and then one other comment I want to make, there's a lot of comments about alcohol businesses, bringing other alcohol businesses in there. Well, we're trying approval for ourselves, but there's other businesses that we go hand in hand. Another business a couple of doors down is loving the idea of us coming in here, the climbing wall community. They can't wait for us to start open our area because our businesses can feed off each other there too. It's just not only alcohol brings alcohol. There's several other industries that pair well with us. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, with that, I'm going to close the public hearing and bring it back to the commission. Do we have any comments?
I need to disclose some ex parte communication.
Okay.
I attended the information and outreach meeting on Friday, April the 15th, hosted by Libertine for neighboring businesses and owners of A Street. I went to the project site on Saturday, April 9th. From approximately 12 p.m. to 2. I walked the area, and in the process, while checking the mail, I spoke to some of the building occupants and owners, including Mr. Sims. These were impromptu meetings. They weren't scheduled. So those are my disclosures.
Okay. Would you have any comments you'd like to make?
I do. Well, I would love to share some of my observations on my site visit. I saw a full parking lot, not overflowing, but a full parking lot, 29 cars on a Saturday in the afternoon. I observed, as has been said, that the shared driveway is extremely narrow with almost no flexibility for passing due to the palm trees with the raised hardscape that serves as the center stripe. More than one building occupant indicated to me that their operating hours conform to project-based work rather than normal business hours, and that was consistent with some of the cars that were parked when I arrived and the same cars still in the space when I left. The martial arts business is three doors down from the proposed tasting room. It had quite a bit of come-and-go traffic and had activity. In some cases, those vehicles associated with that use were parked in a manner that took up more than one space, suggesting a quick drop-off or pickup. And the vehicles, there was at least one vehicle that was too large to fit in the standard space and had diagonally parked there. And I also made a note that none of the parking spaces reserved for disabled were being utilized. Another comment, observation, all of these things are factoring into the information that we've received and then my own observation. But My understanding from staff is that the martial arts business is one of two businesses in the A Street Center that have applied and received a conditional use permit in order to operate their business in the industrial type zoning. And conditioned by their permit to maintain shared parking agreements. Based on the contents of some information submitted to the record by Stevens and Stevens, as well as the proximity, when I was walking the property, it did cross my mind that we had not addressed if these shared parking spaces are actually the same parking places that are agreed to for the businesses in close proximity. And I asked myself, I wondered if that was the case. Well, the proximity, there's where the applicant building is, and then three doors down is the martial arts. And my understanding, based on the addresses that were mentioned in the letter where there's shared parking agreements, it's right next to adjacent, and the martial arts also has the two adjacent. So I'm wondering if it's the same parking places.
Okay.
So I do think that parking is an unresolved issue, and I think it's going to follow the life of this project because of the unique way that the parking spaces in this complex are private and they are legally attached to the buildings. So while I think there's been an enormous attempt at rectifying that, I do think that it is going to be an ongoing problem. Those are some of my comments.
Okay. Any additional comments?
No, go ahead.
Commissioner Dickerson?
Since I've been asked. I've been torn on this project since we first saw it on the 6th. And the reason why is, and I think for many of the if not all of the commissioners, is that overall, the business is a good business. I mean, we like the idea of the business in our community. We like what it is you guys do and the clientele you bring in. The housing of the items, of the beer, the repackaging, all of that fits very nicely into this industrial area. The one problem that we have is obviously the tasting, and especially as we look towards wanting to get things like tasting into Santa Maria, but not necessarily into industrial areas. We want to get them downtown, so that becomes kind of something that, you know, lingers in the back of my mind, this commissioner's mind. Then I go down the road of the other side of the coin, and I have, on numerous occasions, as my fellow commissioners can attest to, I have voted for things based on how they impact their neighbors. I don't believe that there should be a zero-sum game where the negative of a new thing coming in is it degrades the positive of the people who are already there. And so I'm concerned because this is not zoned for this. And if everybody in the complex agreed to it, or at least everybody nearby agreed to it, then I would be in favor of this CUP. But the fact is that you have a neighbor that owns property there, bought property there under a certain philosophy of the zoned uses for that property. And I just cannot see supporting the CUP based on the fact that you have someone who objects to it so much, and clearly for whatever reasons, emotional or actual physical reasons, does not want to be that close to this particular type of thing. So I can't see, you know, asking them to suffer when they have put their own money into it, and
So that's kind of where I stand.
Okay. Any other comment? Commissioner Andrade?
I just have a couple of comments. As I understand the parking arrangements, which I granted is a bit confusing, they have parking, correct me if I'm wrong, for 14 people. And so beyond that, they've got to have shared parking agreements. So if they don't get shared parking agreements, they still have, as I understand it, at least as we had proposed the last time, 14 spaces that are allocated to this project. So, and all we had said last week or last time was that that can increase to 20 if they've got an approved shared parking agreement. So I think the parking is pretty well settled. Now,
could I add one update to that? I think there's 7 parking places, and based on the formula we're applying, we're assuming there'd be 2 people per car, and that's where the 14 came from. But there
right.
are 7
yes,
parking
that's
places.
That's right. You're, okay. you're correct. 14 is a maximum number of patrons based on the parking that's associated with this project. So this project doesn't have to have an agreement with anybody else in order to have 14 people, as I understand it. Mm-hmm. But if they want more, then they've got to make some accommodation, and that is have a shared parking agreement in that's signed, sealed, and delivered. With regard to, this is a difficult issue. This is really a hard case. It speaks to what 2 property owners have as their own property interests. And I'm not sure that someone's personal position, maybe opposing alcohol, maybe opposing different kinds of things, is sufficient, at least for the commission, to say, okay, we'll deny the CUP because of your personal predilections. I don't think that we can make that finding, and I don't think that's appropriate. We can, however, if we believe that there's parking issues, if we believe that it will impact another business without any mitigation that we impose, we can deny the CUP based on real potential problems, real limitations, real effects on another business. Is it sufficient that somebody won't be able to find a parking? I don't know. Maybe it is enough. I think that both of these businesses can work together. I think that that the tasting room and the brewing folks are going to be hyper vigilant about potentially losing that portion of their permit. And I'm hopeful that they don't have any impacts on other locations. They've given us examples of where this has worked in other areas, in other cities. I think it's what's happening. You know, it's going to be the future, whether we like it or not. Some folks don't want to come downtown, and we don't have enough incentives necessarily to bring them downtown. But I think we're looking at 2 projects here that if each of them are good neighbors or is a good neighbor, then, you know, they can make it work. But if not, if they don't want to do that, then it's not going to work. So that's why I think it is a hard decision. But I think that with limiting the project to 14 people, I think that's going to work. So my view would be to approve this project, and that's how I will vote.
Okay. Yes.
Just as a side to that, we haven't had any indication from, for instance, Mr. Sims or any of the other folks that that what they're bringing up is an objection to alcohol. Everything that Mr. Sims and the people that supported him were talking about were physical issues that they had with running their business, an industrial business, and bringing people in and then interacting with patrons of other things. So I just wanted to bring that up. It's not to anything on record, there's nothing that's an anti-alcohol issue. That may be the case, but it's just not been brought forth for the record.
No, I was just reacting to your statement because that's what you said. You said that some person's personal feelings opposing something was something that was something you'd considered in your decision, and I'm suggesting that we really can't do that. That we need to look to see parking. That's a possibility. I mean, that maybe that is a problem. Maybe that will be a problem. I'm not sure. But so that was the only reason I'd
right.
raise that.
That's fair. I understand. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Pratt, you have any other comments?
I actually would be hard-pressed to disagree with anything that's been said from my fellow commissioners. But we all do have a way of we bring our own experience to the table, and my primary issue and keying right off of the issue that the staff I think rightly pointed out in the staff report is the parking. I do think that, and I did want to say that while I think it is completely reasonable and logical how we're looking at the seven spaces in the front, equating to a right number of being 14, I think one of those seven spaces is a disabled parking space. I do not think that will conform to the formula we've applied. And so therefore, I think it's actually a lesser number than that, that fits with the parking that they own. So I would add that piece to it. That's just my own observation. It might be right, it might be wrong. But I think it feeds into the whole parking of that thing. The tightness of that complex is a concern for what's existing. And I actually went to the site three times, from my visit on Saturday to the event that Libertine held, and then I went back one more time on Monday. And it is by far the busiest lane or driveway, whatever you want to call, in that A Street complex. And I know we want to come from a place of being flexible, but I think the CUP that's been granted in that driveway may take up all the flexibility we have for parking and off hours. So I agree that the findings need to be based on those objective pieces of, and it's truly a location issue. It's where you are. I there are other places in half a block that are completely different and do work for that use. But this one is difficult for the way it's sited, how close the proximity is to your neighbors. There's no buffer. And the parking being assigned and privately owned by those buildings creates a challenge that I don't believe I'm going to be able to get over. I want to add to my comments that I have complete confidence in the management and the well intentions of your team. In my estimation, I agree with you that you've gone the extra mile to be neighborly. And we need more entrepreneurial spirit in Santa Maria, not less. We need a lifestyle vibe for people that live here, and you offer that. I absolutely recognize that. It's what makes this a grueling decision. And oh, how I wish we were looking at this in the context of downtown mixed use or one of our new newer retail commercial developments. But try as I might, and even with, I think, too many sacrifices that you all have agreed to in your proposed conditions, I can't make the finding that the tasting room in the proposed location is not going to have an adverse effect upon abutting properties. So that's where I am.
Thank you. Any other comment from the commission? Well, just as I mentioned in the last meeting, I truly believe that we continue to place conditions on this particular business because it doesn't belong in that area. And while it's a great business and brings a lot of people from all over the world, this is not the location. I want to be proactive, not reactive when it comes to issues, and I don't want other businesses there who are going to have an adverse effect to be coming to Planning Commission or causing more issues with calling law enforcement. It seems that we keep hearing that message from other businesses, which shows me that I can't make a finding that it will have no adverse effect on abutting property because it's conditioned in a certain way. And the processing, the storing is all great for the industrial zone, but it's just not, I cannot find a way to make that finding that it will not have an adverse effect. And for those reasons, I don't see myself voting for this project. So with that said, can I get a motion?
We don't have this outlined in our staff report, but is it would the recommendation for denying the CUP be as simple as that?
Yes.
Okay. I would make a recommendation that the Planning Commission, by motion, I'll make a motion that the Planning Commission decline the conditional use permit U2016-00003.
Can I get a second?
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Those opposed?
Aye.
Abstentions? Motion carries. Okay, with that, we are going to move on to item number 4. It's the zoning ordinance text amendment for height flexibility in the plan development overlay districts.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the Commission. This item is a staff-initiated amendment to the zoning ordinance to amend the plan development overlay district to allow flexibility for heights. Currently, the zoning ordinance provides the Commission with authority to approve projects that vary from setbacks, landscaping, and parking rules, subject to certain findings. But not for heights. And historically, it seems there's been an interesting approach that the city has taken. In 2004, a mixed-use ordinance was adopted that does allow the Planning Commission to allow heights to vary, but that's only if it's mixed-use. Then in 2008, for a specific project, the zoning ordinance was amended to allow heights to be increased, but the parameters were such that it would only apply to one site in the whole city. Staff believes that allowing the commission the flexibility on a case-by-case basis, subject to findings, to allow heights to be increased is a logical thing to do. There's a couple cases where it could be used in the short term. If the commission remembers when the Element Church came forward, that was a split-zoned project. The front part was C2, which allows very tall heights. The rear part was R3, and the church wanted to do a youth center, but that youth center would have gone above the heights allowed in R3. There is really not much around that site that would be impacted if that youth center was constructed as proposed. So that would be a case where staff would recommend, if we had that flexibility, to allow that. Also, an item that's coming forward later for a housing project has pointed out examples where just based on roof pitches and how a building may be oriented, that there could be, you know, portions of a roof that go over what the height limit is. when the ordinance was written, the plate heights for apartments, for housing in general, was not as tall. That's the height between the floor and the ceiling. Nowadays, it's generally higher. Used to be 8 feet was normal. Now, I think most people want it in new construction to be closer to 10. Well, if you just extrapolate that up, that makes a three-story building 6 feet taller. So in lieu of trying to do studies to figure out what the exact height should be in various districts, we recommend adding the flexibility into the PD ordinance regulations. The prior item, I think, is a good example of the use of findings. A determination was made whether a permit was appropriate based on whether the commission believed it had impacted the surrounding area. The same language is proposed on the PDs for heights. In addition, there's specific language that the commission would have to determine first that the variation in height is needed for the project. So if a project just wants to come in and ask for additional heights just because, they have to prove to the commission that it's warranted. Then the commission would have to find that the amount of height variation requested is the minimum needed to achieve the purpose of the project. So that gives the commission the authority to, on a case-by-case basis, to determine whether or not a requested extra height variation is warranted. Staff believes that that language provides the ability for the commission to protect and make sure extra heights don't occur in areas where they shouldn't, where it's a sensitive area, but gives you the flexibility in areas where it makes sense to allow it. So with that, staff's recommending approval of the language. We're open to adjustments in the findings or in the language. There are additional findings that could be considered if the commission's interested, but otherwise we're available for any questions.
Okay, any questions by the commission?
I have a few questions. First of all, my apologies for not being at the study session the other day where maybe some of these questions were already answered. The downtown specific plan, of course, the new one, we have a cascading height starting at the center and working our way down as you go from district to district. Do you see this impacting at all that vision that now you're going to end up potentially dotting different areas with heights that are kind of up and down versus this kind of idea that you had like that?
The intent of the regulation is that whereas in downtown where one area might be allowed to be up to 70 feet tall and then it can go to 60 and then maybe down to at 40 feet in like the bungalow district, that if a project in the bungalow district had an architectural element that was just part of the whole project that exceeded the height limit, that depending on what's around it, the commission might think that's acceptable. If not that the whole project is going to be 70 feet tall when that area was supposed to be in the ballpark of only being at 40 feet. So it's really looked at as case by case that the particulars of that project make it fit in. And if the determination is made, what's being asked for does not fit in because of what's in the surrounding area, then staff would not support that level of exception and would recommend that the commission not do that.
But I guess I have concern that we may not end up being really talking about an architectural element, that we may end up talking about another floor. And if they can prove that, as we see, as the system gets gamed, they are proving and saying we categorically have to have another floor, then all of a sudden everything starts to balloon up, and it's already hard enough to keep things at the current rate heights that they are. And then you put us or even staff in a position of having to disprove their claim. And how are you going to do that?
That's a scenario that could happen, and it was discussed. What was considered was language in the ordinance amendment that would say that the height exception would not add any additional intensity to the project. And one could argue an extra floor, that's intensity, or and so on and so forth. So in the end, we didn't put that in the recommendation because we felt that the other findings would suffice, but that was thought of, and the commission could put that as a finding that the height being asked for can't add additional intensity.
If you guys thought about putting it in, but then you withdrew it, I mean, what was the thinking there? Why did you want to withdraw it?
The conclusion, we reached the conclusion that the findings we developed, we thought were enough. But you are correct that it would put the city on the defensive to have to prove that something being asked for beyond the zoning is too much, whereas the exception really is supposed to be about the applicant proving that they need that extra amount. So if language to that effect would be perfectly fine, and it would be something along the lines of the exception shall not otherwise add additional intensity to the project.
The only other question I had was, would this impact things that we've run into recently, scaled up towers? Would this impact that as well, where now there's a perfectly reasonable argument that they would be able to make that, well, we need a tower to be 75 feet or 80 feet or 100 feet because that's how this project works?
Well, I mean, the finding the commission would have to make, the commission would have convinced that the height variation asked for is needed. If it's a large building that otherwise looks like it could have met the height requirements, but they are proposing floor-to-ceiling heights that are beyond the normal, which is not hard for us to find out. If there's industry standards for various types of uses, retail plate heights are really high in general, office is normally a little lower, and then residential is a bit under that, roughly speaking. If someone came in proposing retail plate heights for a housing project and say they need it, we would have a pretty easy time of countering that. And if it does come down the line that some applicant comes forth and in the opinion of the commission abuses the opportunity for the flexibility, more language can be added in to really make it a lot tighter that it can't be used in this case, can't be used in that case. At this point, we think that someone coming forward with something that wasn't reasonable would be pretty plain to see.
Yeah, I don't disagree that it'd be plain to see. I just question whether it'd be easy to block. You know, that always becomes the conundrum, mm-hmm. doesn't it? Okay, well, those are all my questions. For myself, I would like to see that additional text you were talking about. I think that it protects you guys down the road, makes it a little bit easier for you to make your defense. But I don't know what the rest of the commission is thinking.
Okay. Additional questions, comments by the commission?
Yeah, I'd like a question. So, Peter, what you're saying is that the whole project can't be over that height. So an additional floor would make the whole building over that height. We're talking about architectural nuances, a cupola, something, a pergola, whatever they're putting up there, a tower. So we're not, as far as the project goes, they wouldn't be able to come in and say, I want to build a three-story building here, and everything's going to be over that height limit. We're just talking about certain aspects of the architecture.
In staff's view, in order to make the finding that the variation is the minimum needed, it realistically couldn't be the whole building unless it's the a style of architecture that had a particularly high-pitched roof. In that case, or high parapets, or there could be cases. We can't rule them out, but our view is that the finding for it being the minimum needed is something that we would look pretty stringently at. And so that if it's a case of a tower element or a special element that's only on a certain portion of the building, we would be much more supportive of that rather than a whole building.
And that's what's going to be in the language?
Well, the language right now says that in order to approve the height variation, you would have to determine that it's the minimum needed. It's at the minimum.
See? That, yeah. See how tricky that becomes?
Yeah, that is because,
and then we have to prove that that isn't the case.
You have to be convinced. Staff has to prove. You just have to be convinced that it's the applicant and staff who have to prove to the commission for you to comfortably make the finding. Just like on the last project, we made an argument for why we thought the parking would work and not impact neighbors. But there were other points of view and such that led to a decision that the parking did look like it would reasonably impact. So, I mean, that's a case where you will make the judgment call as to how that works.
Can I ask you, and I'm sorry to interrupt, just real fast, if we included that, the text that I was talking about, does staff see an unintended consequence of that? I mean, is there a downside to putting that text in, or is it all upside? And
about the additional intensity,
yeah,
or stories?
I mean, I don't want to throw something in that wrecks the whole thing. And
we can't think of a case that language would impact. We do recognize things come up all the time that were never foreseen. So having the worst case is a project might have to go through a rezoning.
That is an awesome maybe, Peter.
Yeah, thank you
very much.
And also, this is not on a much of a time constraint, so we can add the language and bring it back. You don't need to make an action without seeing the language.
Commissioner Pratt has a question.
Just two questions. I thought I read, and it's either in the staff report or we discussed it at the study session, that staff had an administrative level improvement on height adjustments for things like parapets and that kind of thing. What's the threshold?
Yeah. So in Exhibit A, the first part of it talked about height of buildings. And there is a paragraph that already exists that it's at the very top of the page. Let me... So if you look at Exhibit A, it's underneath the underlined part because it already exists. It allows the director to allow heights in excess when it's determined to be safe and have no adverse impact on surrounding property. It doesn't say how much, but it does give kind of the caveats of what's being talked about. These are really things for mechanical equipment, the fact that an elevator is going to have a penthouse structure. The exception we're talking about is that it's not functionally needed for a stairwell or an elevator, but maybe it's architecturally needed or otherwise found to be that we can't tie it directly to a building code need or something. So there is already flexibility that heights can exceed the ordinance for those type of rooftop equipment.
Okay, and then I'm getting off into a territory that I don't fully understand in my next question, so I apologize if I don't word this and it's confusing, but let me try. My understanding is that with housing, there are going to be times when what is in place by the state preempts our ability, and perhaps a density bonus is an example of that. How is that gonna play with what you're suggesting?
So like in the case of a density bonus, the state law allows a developer to ask for concessions if there's a density bonus. So arguably they don't need to have this type of flexibility. If they needed the height and could show that having the extra height or the reduced setback or reduced parking or those type of things is necessary to make the project work, the city is basically has our hands tied unless we can prove it's not needed.
Okay.
All the other cases are opposite. The applicant has to prove it's needed, and you have to be convinced. If you didn't receive enough information from an applicant to convince you that what's being asked for is needed, you can simply say, I can't meet the finding yet. You haven't provided enough. Okay. Now, I mean, realistically, if if it's a modest exception, the stringency that will it will be looked at will be modest. If it's a major exception, then we are going to look a lot closer at it. There will be cases where it will be a tougher action because it's not as black and white. But the alternative is projects are forced to redesign, or we have to amend the whole ordinance or change the zoning on a project just to get around a relatively minor thing.
I lied. One more question. I guess they didn't want me to. Have we received any feedback from the development community on this issue?
Only from the people who have projects that would benefit from it, and they are supportive.
Okay.
Since it was a proposal for flexibility, it wasn't thought, and not like a added restriction, it wasn't thought that it needed a major outreach.
Okay, well, I guess my point was, where's the balance between flexibility and certainty for folks looking so that when they put those dollars out before they come and before they talk to you, that there's some certain, there's a good feeling of what they've designed would fit within the parameters.
And that could be very much, if a project came in asking for some flexibility, that would be a topic for like an early study session to show the commission the surrounding area and get your feedback on should this building be allowed to be a little taller or not.
Thank
you.
No.
One additional. Do you have public?
Lori Tamura, if you can state your name and address for the record. Thank you.
Sure. Lori Tamura with Urban Planning Concepts, 2624 Air Park Drive. We're in favor of the clarification of including heights as a element for modification by the Planning Commission or, if need be, the City Council. This is the first time I've seen the final version of the text changes, so I'd like to make a couple of suggestions. The first one is in regards to maximum height exceptions. I'm actually looking at Exhibit A. And as far as I know, within the city zoning ordinance, the word variation is not a real legal planning term. You refer usually to a planning commission approving modifications. And actually, as you go down further into the intent, you see they are permitted to modify heights, landscaping, parking. So I think that to avoid any confusion of bringing a new word into the lexicon of the zoning ordinance, they should use the word modification. So the sentence would say, when the Planning Commission determines the modification is necessary, and I would delete the last part of that sentence, because you are now putting in a subjective determination of architectural design of a building to that may be a superior design, but is it the minimum design? And so I would say delete that sentence and say determination of the modification is necessary for the design of the project. Because we're encouraging.
Which paragraph, which section are we talking
sure,
about?
Sure, it's under item, it's the first one that says section 12.2.74,
okay.
Height of buildings, down to B.
Okay.
And this is the new language that was inserted by staff.
Right.
And the last line says determination of variation, and the word should be changed to modification.
Okay.
So determination of the modification is necessary, and then delete everything else that's underlined and add in the words for the design of the project. And as and the reason I'm suggesting this wording is we're being encouraged by the staff to be creative and think about new ways of designing buildings. And as you know, the heights of each room have gotten bigger in each building. Then you have the plate, and then you have another either 9 or 10 foot ceiling, and then you have another plate. You're already at 35 feet before you even put a pitched roof on the top of the building. So I think the design of the buildings are going to be the driving force, not a minimum standard or a minimum justification. It should be raising the bar. And so I would suggest wherever the word variation is, change it to modification and focus on the design of the project that people are bringing forward.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. With that, we don't have any written communication, so I'm going to close the statements. And do we have any additional? No. It says for item 6.
Mr. Toast, I didn't expect to speak on this, but I think I could add some clarity to it.
Okay. So if you can just state your name and address.
Michael Tobes of the Tobes Group, Santa Barbara. I don't know whether staff can put up our PowerPoint now, but the first slide in our PowerPoint, I think, is a very good example of what we are proposing. Can that PowerPoint be put on the screen now?
I think it's going to take most of the time. Just trying to get it on. So.
Okay. So if you want to speak, and they will try to put it on for us.
Well, I think when we submitted our project for an initial review with city staff, we had a very flat ridgeline at 35 feet. We couldn't do anything less than 35 feet. And the suggestion was, as we discussed it, that there was a possibility that the ordinance might be changed and that we could get a little variance in the roof line and make the building more attractive and more interesting if we could have some variance. And what you will see tonight will be, this is a perfect example of what we have. We had a very flat roof line there with you know, we didn't have that cupola on there or the two increases in height, one there and one a little further down, which really I don't think destroy the spirit of the height limit the city has, but I think makes the elevations of the building much more interesting. And that's an example of what would be allowed under this change in your ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson.
With that, I'm going to bring it back to the commission. Any additional comments or questions? No?
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Mr. Seifert?
Thank you, Chairman. Peter, wouldn't Mr. Toews be able to do those without this change? If he came to you and said, this is what I want to do, and does he need this?
Yes.
Easy answer.
That was easy.
Cold, cruel, succinct.
Commissioner Dickerson?
I have a question for
legal.
For legal, thank you. Mr. Moore is wanting to swap modification for variation. Would you look at that as a positive, a neutral? I mean, is there a point to it or not?
Commissioner Hernandez, members of the commission, I would ask staff if they have any particular reason they chose that word as opposed to modification. I understand Mr. Murr's point, and it does make sense unless there was a particular reason why staff chose the word variation. I think it makes sense from a legal point of view to be consistent with the general terminology. I'm not sure about her other suggestion about deleting the rest of the sentence, but I would defer to staff on that.
Yeah, and I was just asking specifically about the variation versus modification.
And I'd like to note, too, that variation is used all throughout the chapter. So I don't know if that's changing it here is going to affect the rest of your intended definitions.
Yeah, I think your point was that modification is used throughout the chapter and the variation is not common, but I'm not certain of that.
Well, yeah, but in the intent section, it talks about variation.
Right. The requested it's
throughout. So
it is 1235.201 intent. If you go to D, you use the word variations. If you
and those are all new added text.
Okay.
Yeah, it's added text.
I mean, the term. I'm not certain why the term was used. It is a little too close to another zoning term of variance, which we're not doing. The only, I'm at this point more likely to support using the word exception. In prior areas where modifications talked about, it spells out the modified such and such requirement. And would rather not keep using that many words in each location. But there's no question that we can change the word to one that's more used, and exception is used in the ordinance.
Okay. Any other questions? No? So are we going to agree that we're going to change it? Or is that?
May I ask?
Yes.
Is it going to come back to us then if it sort of suggests that there should be some cleanup language?
Yeah. Mentioned earlier, this is not necessarily on a tight time frame. Basically, this ordinance just has to be effective before any of the building permits for projects that might need this go into our issue. So there is time available. Our suggestion would be for any change that we bring it back to a future meeting, and that you see the final language.
So would we move to continue this thing?
Yes. Yeah.
With direction that staff revise it in accordance with what the okay. direction you've given.
I would like to make a motion then that we continue this. Do we have to give a specific date or we continue it to?
We would like to do it to a specific date, and I believe the date that we would prefer, and Kathleen, correct me if this isn't a hearing, is June 1st a hearing? Mm-hmm. Yes. So we would like it to be June 1st.
Okay. I'll make
our meeting in May, we only have one, and it is booked.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion that we move this to June 1st. We table this to June 1st with the swapping of the text as we've described, variation becomes exceptions. Or something of a similar nature?
I would think you look at it, because it may work on one part of that sentence, right. But it may not work on others, so.
Yeah, so I mean, if the direction could be to avoid the use of that word and find a better word.
Yeah, something more commonly within the lexicon of what we already have. Yeah, that's fine. And then I don't know if the rest of the commissioner, I would like to have added in that one additional sentence put in to protect staff to down the road, unless somebody has an objection to that.
Yeah. No.
Then that will be my motion.
No, I'll just add, I think it may be communicated in looking at the terminology, but the other comments that were made, to the extent that we don't reinforce minimum standards, I would love to see you look at that language too. And if that's the right language, fine, but I'd like some look at that.
Okay. And we can do that. I can say now we think that's very important.
Okay.
Because otherwise it does lead to the, it depends on one's perspective. One could look at the findings a commission makes as being partially based on a subjective view. You are appointed officials who represent the community. Mm-hmm. It, when you look at a project, you need to decide that the amount being asked for is not being overdone. And so I think it's important having that type of language. Right. Other approaches are to try to put like a percentage on it, but I can see scenarios where an acceptable element might be over a certain percentage.
Okay, fair enough. I just, the idea that we would do anything to reinforce that we were looking for minimum design aesthetic, I thought was important. So if that's what it needs to be, then I withdraw my comment.
And that's my motion.
Second. I'll second that motion to continue to June 1 with that direction.
With all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries.
Okay.
And with that, we can take a quick 5-minute break. We are going to start with the heavier items, so we're going to ask for a 5-minute break. Thank you.
Where's your boss?
What? Regroup.
I'm not barely. I was late to council meeting about dinner yet. I know.
Okay, we're going to call the meeting back to order. Going to move on to item 5, the General Plan Land Use Map Amendment and Zone Change for Prisker Commercial Center at the northwest corner of North Broadway and Prisker Lane. Staff, if we can start your presentation.
Good evening, Chair, Commissioners. The next project before you is the development of Prisker Commercial Center. There are multiple permits for this project. They are applying for a general plan amendment, a zone change, and adoption of a mitigated negative declaration, as well as a plan development permit. Tonight, we will be focusing on the general plan amendment and the zone change, as well as the MND. The plan development permit will be coming back for your approval on May 18th, so we will not be focusing on any of the PD permit conditions or that aspect of the project. I will briefly go through the site plan and the elevations, but won't be focusing my discussion on that. Tonight, I will be focusing just on the rezone and the general plan amendment for the site. Currently, the site is located on the northwest corner of Presker Lane and North Broadway, right off the 101 interchange of North Broadway. The applicant is applying for a general plan amendment and zone change from FS Freeway Service to a CC general plan designation, which is community commercial, as well as a zone change from FS, which is freeway service, to PD-F/C2, which is a planned development overlay, as well as a freeway tower overlay, and a C2 general commercial zoning district. Staff is in support of this amendment. The reason the applicant is applying for it is twofold. One of the reasons is for addition in height. Similarly to the item we just discussed about the modifications in height amendments, the hotel that's proposed for this project is a four-story Hampton Inn, and the plate height of that hotel is 39 feet, which is under the 40-foot requirement or limitation of the FS zoning district. However, the roof parapet and the tower elements of the hotel do exceed that height. And so one of the reasons for the rezone of the site is to be able to get the additional flexibility in height that the C2 zoning district does allow. But secondly, the second reason for that is for a flexibility in uses for the site. The FS zoning district has a very limited use of commercial uses on the site. They're pretty much limited to service stations, hotels, or restaurants in the FS zoning district. And this zoning district is clustered around our interchanges of the freeway in the city, and it was intended to put freeway service type uses in that area. Staff believes that the FS zoning district actually is an unnecessary zoning district now, that a commercial zoning district would meet all of the needs for the freeway patrons that are traveling by our city, as well as be able to service the surrounding communities that are around these sites. Our experience has been that it limits the ability for the property owner to put specialty uses or a broader range of commercial uses on their site, and they're limited to just fast food restaurants or hotels or a gas station. And it begs the question, is this what we want to see clustered around every interchange in the city, or do we want to be able to have a wider variety and see some more commercial uses or uses that serve the surrounding neighborhood as well as the freeway? So staff is supporting the rezone and really would like to bring up the topic in the future of, should we eliminate the FS zoning district altogether and make that just a commercial zoning district that can serve both the freeway and the community? So that is the main topic for tonight, is the general plan amendment and zone change, as well as the adoption of a mitigated negative declaration that was done for the project. Just to give you a look at the site plan, which has come before the Planning Commission at a couple of study sessions, there is a four-story hotel proposed on the site, as well as three one-story buildings that will front North Broadway. The one at the tip of the Presker Lane and North Broadway will be a Wendy's fast food restaurant with a drive-through. The other two pads do not have any proposed tenants at the time, but are envisioned to be a multi-tenant building in the center, and then a sit-down restaurant in the far corner. The elevations are a more modern architectural style with clean lines and bold colors. Here's just elevations of all three of the one-story buildings, and then the hotel has redesigned their building to be in fitting with the architectural style of the other buildings, and has a more modern feel to it. Here's a rendering perspective of Presker Lane looking onto the project site. And then if you were to turn from Presker Lane onto North Broadway, headed to the freeway, here's a glimpse of what that would look like, and then further down. Staff is recommending that the Planning Commission do recommend to City Council approval of the general plan amendment and zone change, as well as adoption of the mitigated negative declaration. That concludes staff's presentation. We're available for questions, as well as the applicant's architectural team and hotel owners are here.
Thank you. So do we have any questions for staff? Commission?
I have a quick question. Is staff satisfied with the improvements that the hotel, the structure for the hotel is at this point?
Yes, we are. The hotel heard the feedback from the Planning Commission and went through and worked very closely with Hampton Inn and their architects in coming up with a more modern architectural style. They incorporated the clean lines and materials that matched some of the other buildings. They are sharing materials and elements with the other buildings, so we believe it's a much more cohesive design of the overall project now. And staff is very happy with the modifications that were made.
Good. Thank you.
Would the applicant like to make a presentation?
Good evening. Jody Belsick, Walker Engineering, 1723 21st Street, Santa Monica. I just want to say a few words. We've got Damon Porter here with Dynamic Development, the owner, and the hotel, Nilesh Patel. And we just want to say thanks to the staff. We've been working on this project for probably over a year with staff, and we're really happy to be here and recommending approval. And this is, everyone's really excited, and we want to say thanks.
Thank you. Okay. Do we have questions for the applicant? No? Okay. We didn't have any public comment for this item, so we're going to close the public hearing and bring it back to the commission. And if we could get a motion for the resolution number 2684.
I will move for approval of recommendation. I missed that. Do we need to give the number?
Yes.
2684. Do I need to read off 1, 2, and 3?
No. We have to do it.
Okay.
Separately.
Okay. Yes. So. Very good. So the first one being recommend that the City Council adopt a mitigated negative declaration. And
second.
Thank you.
Can we get a roll call?
Commissioner Pratt?
Aye.
Commissioner Andrade?
Aye.
Commissioner Seifert?
Aye.
Commissioner Dickerson?
I believe so.
Chair Hernandez?
Aye. Okay. Can we do the next resolution? Number.
By resolution, I recommend that the City Council approve General Plan Land Use Map Amendment and Zone Change, GPZ 2015-004.
Second.
Can I get a roll call?
Commissioner Seifert?
Aye.
Commissioner Andrade?
Aye.
Commissioner Pratt?
Aye.
Commissioner Dickerson?
Aye.
Chair Hernandez?
Aye. And the third one, if I can get a motion.
I will go ahead and move that we continue the plan development permit until after the City Council deals with the resolutions to May 18, 2016.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstain? Motion carries. Mm-hmm. Congratulations. Okay, with that, we're going to move on to item number 6. Which is a general plan land use map amendment, zone change, specific plan amendment, and plan development permit for the Westgate Senior Apartments.
Yes, as stated, this is a general plan map amendment, zone change, specific plan amendment. There's also an associated plan development permit, and there's also an amendment to a prior plan development permit for the shopping center that the proposed GPZ is going to be taking up part of. For this meeting, we are going to be focusing once again on the GPZ, on the general plan, zone change, and specific plan amendment. There are extra handouts that were provided. Thank you. There are extra handouts.
Tons of respect.
Yes, exactly. That supplement the general plan amendment and zone change. They're the maps that go along with the proposed resolution, as well as an extra sheet that goes in the specific plan that has the table of the acreages within the specific plan area. So those were handed out up at the dais. This site's within the Blosser Southwest plan. It was adopted in 1994, and the Tobes Group owns the subject site and is proposing to change part of it, which is which is stands out right here. Currently, this entire area is in the PDCC, and Tobes Group proposes to change the rear part of it to R3, which allows housing. Just looking at the map of the rest of the specific plan area, you'll see that it's part of the plan to have apartments, higher density, up along Blosser as a buffer for the single family homes to the rear. So the idea of taking part of the shopping center and making the rear part into apartments goes right along with that. Originally, the Tobes Group inquired whether the city would be supportive of changing the entire part over to housing. Staff was concerned with losing the land that actually fronts on Blosser. It's understandable that until all the housing in the area is built, that the retail may not have enough out there to attract the tenants, but we didn't want to lose all of the frontage. The Tobes Group adjusted their proposal and is only asking to change the part on the rear, which is much appreciated. But I think, you know, the pattern of land uses shows having R3 between the more intensive uses and the main street and the housing behind is a good land use approach. So and that is one of the reasons staff is in full support of this change. This is just an exhibit that was actually from a PD permit that the commission looked at long ago for the housing project to the rear. But this shows up front the site plan of the shopping center that is on the Tobes property. So it was originally planned and approved for a larger shopping center that came up to the border of the housing behind it. What is proposed to change is roughly where the red line is. On one side, that will stay as commercial. On the back side, that will go to senior housing. So this part here would be senior housing. You see how that lines up with the ARCO AMPM property line, roughly speaking. Staff's very confident that enough property of depth exists that a neighborhood-serving shopping center would be able to work here. It's not likely that with what happened at Bedarrieta Plaza and that industrial changing over to changing over to retail, that we could get that many large retail centers in this area. So we actually think shrinking this shopping center in this manner is acceptable because there will still be enough in the overall area. Also, on the other side of the street, there is land use and zoning for having some amount of retail on Blosser as well. So staff's not concerned with the loss of retail. The one note that was discussed at the study session that has since been, staff believes is going to be worked out in time for the PDs to come back to the commission, is the importance of having a pedestrian link between the housing and the shopping center. Based on meetings since the study session, staff is very optimistic that that's going to be worked out. We are putting a notation in the specific plan land use map that calls for having some type of connection. It's meant to be very very loosely interpreted. It's not saying the connection has to be here and this connection has to be here. It turns out that the connections will likely be where the arrows are, but that's just a coincidence. But it is saying how it's important that the apartments have a connection as well as the neighborhood to the rear. This is a conceptual site plan that follows in the same orientation. So Battles is along the bottom. This is the site plan of the senior housing. And this is a conceptual site plan of what the retail center might look like. And if you just compare that to what the original, it is basically the same layout. It's just the rear part of the project has been cut off. At this point, we don't know for certain that there's not going to be other issues with site circulation and such. So this layout might not be able to hold true exactly, but we're going to work with the applicant to have that worked out by the time this comes back. The reason an amendment to the marketplace permit's important is because once the rear part changes to R3, the old PD permit is arguably invalid because it had a shopping center on land that's no longer commercial. So we want to approve an amendment at the same time that notes that the site has shrunk, but otherwise make sure that the environmental review does not have to be repeated as the shopping center moves forward. This was shown earlier in a different slide on the other item. It's an example of the architecture of the senior project. Staff's very very supportive of it. There's a lot of articulation, varying of wall planes and of roof forms, lots of detail and such. So when the PD does come forward, architecturally staff is very supportive of the project. But for tonight, we're asking for the commission to pass resolutions for council consideration. One is for a negative declaration. Just in general, the old shopping center studied all the environmental impacts of what the larger shopping center would be. Changing the rear part to senior housing actually results in reduced impacts across the board because there's less traffic for a senior housing project than there would be for that part of the shopping center. So it's a negative declaration, not a mitigated. There are no mitigation measures in this case. So staff recommends approval of that. The general plan land use and zoning amendments for which the exhibits have been shared at the dais. And then the specific plan amendment, which is basically to change the map for the land use and the table for the acreages at the rear of the document. All of those can be passed simply by following the recommendation section of the staff report or on the agenda. The continuance for the plan development permit is recommended to June 15th. That is longer than the prior item because there are a few more issues that have to be worked out between now and the approval of the PDs. But overall, staff believes this is a very good project. While it does reduce the amount of commercial area, it does so in what we consider a reasonable, responsible way. It provides senior housing, which is a major need, and it retains all of the benefits for the neighboring area that would have occurred prior. So staff's in full support of all of the items on the agenda today.
Are we going to have a presentation by the applicant?
Can I ask one?
Sorry.
What are the specific modifications or variations to the specific plan? What is the specific plan amendment?
So the specific plan amendment, it changes two maps, basically in the same manner as shown above, except the specific plan's not in color. We're not adding color, just because it's a 1994 document, so we're leaving the black and white. But it would show that this is now R3 instead of CC. And then there's a land use version of that. And then there's a table at the end of the document that lists out the acreages of each district. And since the acreages are moving, those numbers are just updated.
Okay, so that's the amendment to this specific plan.
Yes.
Okay, all right, that makes sense.
Are we addressing those walkways today?
The walkways are based on recent meetings, we believe the walkways are going to be addressed to the applicants and staff's satisfaction when the PD permit comes back to the commission. Now, there is a language in the specific plan exhibit that calls for walkways to be put in. It doesn't say exactly where, exactly how they need to be arranged. The applicant can speak to whether or not they are supportive of that or not. Thank
you. Okay. Can we hear from the applicant?
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the Commission. My name is Michael Tobes of the Tobes Group, 21 East Victoria Street, Santa Barbara, California. We started on this change from all commercial shopping center to a combination of senior housing and reduced shopping center a year or so ago. We made presentations to both the Planning Commission and the City Council in terms of the concept of this change, and there was a unanimous support at both levels for what we are now proposing. So we think we are now just in the stages of following through with that moving forward with the senior housing part of the project. The commercial part will still depend on getting tenants. We agree with Mr. Gilley that as more housing is developed here, both with this 193 units and the 299 homes at Heritage Square is building, that demand will be increasing and there will be increased demand for commercial space there. We have worked out a plan for the pathway. I think the staff feels that it will be work. It will not. It will serve both Heritage Square and the seniors project, and accomplish everything that I think the city would like to see there. And we will. We had a brief meeting about it today with staff and showing them in sketch form what we have in mind. I think it will work, and we will have it completely defined for you when we come back to the city, to the Planning Commission on June 15th. The items before you tonight, the first three, the negative declaration, the general plan, land use amendment and zone change, and the specific plan amendment to the Blosser Southwest specific plan. We're in agreement with them. Staff has recommended them. We have no additional comments on them. The plan development permit is going to be continued to the 15th. We have a PowerPoint, but basically the PowerPoint was presented at the study session. It will be presented again on the 15th, and unless you would like to see it tonight, I would say we should just defer it. We'll make a few additional changes and then present the entire package to you on June 15th. Be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Tobes. Any questions from the commission? No? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we do have, you filled out a speaker slip, but I assume that was the comment. And with that, we're going to close the hearing, and if I can get a motion for a resolution.
I'm going to support this, but I do have just two quick questions that I didn't get out when we were talking to staff. In the study session, there was just a little bit of discussion about the bridge that would be going over the drainage. And in the environment, the negative deck, there was emphasis placed in multiple places that it had been built twice. Does that mean that it had been built somewhere else and worked? It was just to say that that would work in terms of the flood control.
But I only saw one on Heritage, that a bridge has been built over channels like this.
Okay. I'm still a little confused, but I'll deal with you after the thing just to make sure I'm clear on what we're talking about.
She'll deal with you.
Poor choice of language. I'll talk to you after the meeting because it's not a point that needs to take up more time.
We appreciate that. Thank you. Okay. Comments?
All right. In that case, I will move that the Planning Commission, by resolution number 2686, recommend that the City Council adopt a negative declaration for the general plan land use map for the West Cambridge Senior Apartments. Is that correct?
I think you just adopt a negative declaration.
Yes.
Confusing the other resolution.
Thank you. Can we get a roll call?
I will second that. Or has it been seconded?
Second.
It has now.
Okay. Second.
Commissioner Dickerson?
Yes.
Commissioner
Andrade?
Aye.
Commissioner
Seifert? Aye.
Chair Hernandez?
Aye. Okay. Item number two.
And I'll move that the Planning Commission, by resolution number 2687, recommend that the City Council approve a general plan land use map amendment and zone change GPZ 2015-0003.
Second.
Aye.
Commissioner
Andrade?
Aye.
Commissioner
Seifert?
Aye.
Commissioner Kraft?
Aye.
Chair Hernandez?
Aye.
I move that the Planning Commission by Resolution Number 2688 recommend that the City Council approve a specific plan amendment SPZ 2016-0001 to the Blosser Southwest specific plan.
Roll call.
Second.
I'm sorry.
Aye.
Commissioner Seifert?
Aye.
Commissioner
Pratt?
Aye.
I just have a question. Is that including, is your motion include the documents that were presented to us today? The new documents?
Certainly.
Okay. Aye.
Aye.
Thank
you.
And finally, I move that that the Planning Commission, by motion, continue Plan Development Permit PD 2015-0020 and Permit Amendment A 2016-0011 to June 15th, 2016.
Second that motion.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. With that, we will move on to item number 7.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. Which is the City of Santa Maria Welcome Sign Special Project at the Highway 101 and North Broadway Interchange. I have the staff presentation.
The last presentation of the evening. This is a joint project between Public Works Department and Community Development Department to install a welcome sign at the Highway 101 North Broadway off-ramp. Yeah, I'll let Peter be my laser pointer. I'll let Peter be my Vanna White. in the location in yellow. This is the first off-ramp if you are heading southbound on Highway 101 into the city of Santa Maria. It's to welcome the patrons on Highway 101 to designate where Santa Maria begins on the freeway. And I, as an iconic definition, much like other communities on the Central Coast that have welcome signs on their freeway, that the City of Santa Maria would like to join the ranks in doing one for our city. So the consultant that we've hired to design the welcome sign as well as engineer it and install it for us has come up with three versions of the welcome sign for the Planning Commission's consideration with a recommendation to City Council on which the Planning Commission thinks should be installed at this location. The first design is Concept A. This design incorporates a tower element similar to the tower element located on this building. It's an iconic feature here in the city, and it's been incorporated in this design to make a nod to that feature. The second design also has a tower element on it. This is Concept B. This design mimics the gable feature on this building as well, elaborates on that, also incorporates the ship logo that's so well known here in the city and used on everything. So that's also incorporated into it. I wasn't trying to be funny about that. And then the third design is Concept C, which is also mission style, but is not particularly built or designed after anything that's a building or iconic feature in the city, but just a classic mission style architectural elements, more symmetrical in design. And all three of them say, welcome to Santa Maria. So staff is just looking for direction and a recommendation from the Planning Commission on which three of these concepts to recommend to City Council for installation. We know that you had one in mind at the study session. Okay. However, everybody was not at the study session, so.
Okay. Do we have any questions from the commission?
I certainly do. I've got a real problem with this project. We heard a lot of stuff at the study session. Are we just discussing the design tonight? Because, Steve Kahn said we're going to move it. Lori Tamura says there's going to be an overpass change. I drove by there. There is signs everywhere blocking this thing. The Caltrans is going to have to move in order to get vision. I mean, I can tell you which one I like. But I haven't liked some of the aspects of this project, and I'm all for having the sign, but moving it later that's not an option. That didn't make any sense to me. Steve Kahn said that. I mean, have you guys talked with him about this?
Yes, we have. So the Public Works Director and Department does not anticipate the expansion or change of this interchange anytime soon.
We did hear to the contrary in study session.
Yes, no. We did from members of Ms. the public.
Tamara.
But from all the involvement that the community or the Public Works Director has in discussions of this and Measure A funding and the timeline of when things are going to happen, there is a huge push from Caltrans to update Highway 101's carpool or vehicular, what are they called?
HOV
lane down in the Santa Barbara area. A lot of funding is going towards that right now. Then what the goal is to improve the Bettoravia interchange, and then they would be looking at additional improvements to other interchanges in the city. So the director does not believe that there would be any kind of modifications to this for a long time. However, in contingency, they are looking at the ideas of designing it, should it need to be moved, when it does happen, sometime in the future. But the direction has been given to staff from city manager's office and some of city council to do a welcome sign in this location. So
I want a welcome sign.
That.
I do.
You have very valid concerns, and staff has looked at all of those concerns and what the designs are for the area, and staff believes, especially the Public Works Department believes, that this is not going to be changing for a long time.
Okay, any questions?
Well, because there's a lot of issues with this. This sign is being proposed higher up than you would see most in other communities because of the fact there is a lot of
sign pollution
of signage on
sign pollution
on the right of way.
Yes.
There.
Yeah, and they are working with Caltrans and the idea of relocating, removing some excess.
It's going to have to happen.
Yeah.
Right. Visibility. I mean, they're building up. If you look at the grading around here, they're building up this whole pad to elevate the sign to get it out of this. So
that's not an existing topo. That's
future. Proposed future topo. So the existing topo is just this.
Yeah, I think existing is dotted lines, and so that's an extension that they're doing.
Yeah, so they're building this all up, which will be grading that will be required, and they are looking at. There are signs here. There are signs here.
Oh,
they're
yeah.
looking at relocating or removing some of those to provide more visibility. So the consultant team we are working with has worked with other cities along the freeway and doing similar things, so they have a lot of experience with one working with Caltrans and these kind of hurdles to jump.
Okay, thank you. Do we have comments by the commission?
I would hate to see us try to move it.
Yeah, so would we.
You want us to suggest which ones we like? Is that
staff is looking at the Planning Commission make a motion to make a recommendation to council which one to install.
Okay.
Your favorite.
So who goes first? Because I like A.
I like A and B.
Oh yeah, that's good. That's close. Yeah.
I'd like a.
You could have your number one choice, your number two choice, your number three choice.
Okay. I'd like A and then B as a runner-up.
All right.
A solid single.
That would be my motion to recommend concept A as the first choice and concept B as the second choice.
I could second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstention. Motion carries. Thank you very much.
I think I forgot to say aye. Sorry.
And we will.
I'm just not there tonight.
And we will add information in the council report about some of the challenges and concerns.
Yeah, because I mean, it was at least a $200,000 project. You know, it's tax money,
and I just don't.
If it's all there and it's going to be there and it's permanent, and my grandkids can see it when they come to town, that's great. But if we're going to plop it up and move it, we're going to be doing it all over again.
Well, I mean, I think at some point it will have to be moved or adjusted. It's just Our view is it's a matter of decades.
Yeah. I can do decades.
And
okay.
Not 5 years.
We don't have any information that would support it happening
in 5 years. Yeah.
Can I ask the staff just real quick? So I assume that the powers that be really wanted to just continue the continuity of the mission style for all the city buildings and structures and that type of thing, as we're reaching out to architects and developers to kind of change things up a little bit. We just, I mean, because did we get anything other than mission style?
The direction to the consultant was to come up with a mission style monument sign.
You want a nautical one?
I just have to. A nautical theme, that's right.
To go with the ship.
Something with Popeye.
And I think it is, nautical. While we have as a group talked about not everything in the city needs to be that, whereas maybe that was the part. I think it is still the
primary.
It's the element of City Hall and many of the buildings. So having it as in these special type of locations as opposed to everywhere, we do see the benefit of
so,
that.
So not everything in the city needs to be mission style, but everything of the city needs to be mission style.
Yes.
Is that right?
Possibly.
Yeah. Okay.
Can I ask what staff's choice was?
A. Concept A.
Consistent.
Good job.
Okay, with that, move on to number 8, report on city council actions.
I would like to request authorization to defer this to tomorrow's study session.
Works for me.
Everybody agree? Is everybody going to be at the study session tomorrow?
I have no idea.
Yes? Okay.
Is it that long?
Okay.
I don't know.
Everybody agree with that?
But yes. Before you adjourn the meeting.
Wait, we have one more thing.
Okay.
Oral reports from Planning Commission and staff, number 9.
I think staff would like to report on the Downtown Friday.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm going to be sure.
I wasn't expecting that. So we had the first Downtown Fridays event after the rain out of what was supposed to be the first Downtown Fridays event. Staff and the event coordinator, Edgar Carey, who is partnering with us in doing this, we estimate about 5,000 to 7,000 people came through the event that evening.
Wow.
From all of the feedback that we've gotten from the community and different city employees and everyone who attended. They enjoyed the event. They loved it. We've gotten lots of great feedback from it. Walking around the event, it was great to see a true reflection of the community was there. Lots of families, every age range was there. There were lots of long lines, but I didn't seem that anybody was bothered by them. People were just talking to each other, and it was like a big Santa Maria reunion. So it was a great feel. We learned a lot from it. There are some things that we're changing for this event. We're tripling the size of the beer and wine tent. Got a lot of
there's
feedback.
There's a takeaway.
Yeah, Liberty.
Can we invite Liberty?
They have asked to participate. For the first year, we do have an exclusive with Budweiser for the event, but after that, we'd like to see others join and be part of the beer and wine tent.
But we did go to bid on that Budweiser and the Coors and... We didn't just award that to Budweiser, right?
You know, for the beginning of this event, it was the challenging components of it was, since we've never done anything like this, there were a lot of people who were hesitant to even participate. Mm-hmm. So we basically took everybody that was willing to start and launch with this. So the people that you see participating in the event are the people that stepped up to the plate and say, mm-hmm. Hey, we're going to take a risk. And so... it was something that Ed, through his connections and the people who are willing to take that risk, signed up and did. So we will have more food vendors for this week. We'll have barbecued turkey legs, which apparently is a big hit in Santa Maria. People were asking for it. We'll have some bratwurst vendors, some chili cheese fries, some additional stuff. Stepping Out will be playing this week. We'll have...
Is it every Friday?
It's for health lovers.
Every Friday?
Every Friday. And one point, many of the vendors may not have believed that we were really going to start at 5, so mm-hmm. they came a little late, and they couldn't get in.
No
so
way.
Some of the additional food that's coming was actually supposed to have already been there, but
now,
didn't make it.
Have we thought about this? Because I know I left early. I saw Phil there. Phil was there. But I came and left, and I'll tell you what, there was 3 people vying for my parking space when I left. Yeah. And getting out of there took a long time. So we really do have an egress access mm-hmm. problem. And I know that San Luis, they shut down their street, and they do it on the street, and they keep all that parking. We probably need to look at this thing for the future, that it is going to create some real issues.
We agree with you. For the immediate solution or trying to mitigate that problem, we are going to have the downtown trolley that's going to be circulating and picking up from the parking structures and dropping off at the event, and hoping to then encourage people to park at the parking structures and then walk over or get a ride over. Long term, we do want to move it into the street.
I don't think it'd be that hard to do.
Is Caltrans?
Yes.
I love your attitude, Tim. I love your attitude about it.
I don't. There's so many people that if you just shut off Broadway,
yeah, Caltrans.
It's Caltrans.
It's Caltrans.
Yeah.
But we can't do anything.
But I'm optimistic, Tim. I am optimistic. I'm hoping to get some data under our belt. If we continue to see volumes like 5,000 people coming weekly, and a traffic jam like it is, I hope to go to Caltrans and present them, hey, there's this huge traffic congestion that's happening every Friday night. It'd be beneficial to you as Caltrans to do a detour and keep the traffic circulation going and avoid any type of pedestrian casualties if you just let us shut off between Main and Cook.
There you go.
So I'm waiting a couple months to get some data and then approach Caltrans with that idea.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, anything else?
Anything else?
If I can sit and still give you a standing ovation, I would. Congratulations. All the hard work, all the
Thank
effort,
you.
All the risk paid off. What you said was exactly what I saw. And while I realized there were a lot of people, which creates issues, I think, aren't we lucky to have those issues?
Mm-hmm.
So congratulations.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Congratulations. I heard before the event, a lot of people were hesitant and they doubted that it would be a successful event. I kept hearing, oh, it's not going to happen. I said, you just wait. It's going to happen. So I was very proud to see that, you know, you came through and that we stepped up to the plate. So thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, as you know, we ran into each other there. It was it's amazing. Hopefully, our success will be met by vendors. You know, that's the key thing. There were, and as you said, there were some issues with some of the food vendors getting in, but the lines were just exceedingly long. And so hopefully other vendors will hear about that and want to show up just because there's so much traffic.
Mm-hmm. It's even San Luis. I mean, you want to get something from one of the big. It's a long line. It takes 20 minutes.
One of the items of concern, I think it's great. Thank you. Great job. But we ought to make sure that we don't, we have the fair that's coming up. I think they have a strawberry festival mm-hmm. coming. So I don't know whether that's going to affect anybody. Some of the same vendors that probably were there usually go to the fair.
Mm-hmm.
And so anyway, that's just something to think about and but good job. Great job.
Thank you.
Yes, good job.
Thank you guys for all your support and making it happen.
With that note, I'm gonna adjourn the meeting. Thank you very much.
You prefer standing ovation.